smoke on them. Don't.
Formed originally in 1965 to encourage recruiting into the Royal Air Force, the Red Arrows are today acknowledged as the premier aerobatic team in the world. Lacing through the sky at 400 miles an hour, 12 feet apart, theirs is a lethal, thrilling world of high-speed, precision flying. The nine team pilots fly the red-painted Hawk, a two-seat aeroplane designed by British Aerospace as a ground attack fighter and as a fast jet trainer. There is a long tradition in the Air Force of formation aerobatics, highlighting the skill and accuracy of the pilots. These Hawker Furies were photographed in 1935. The Red Arrows are based here at RAF Scampton. Set amid the flat Lincolnshire countryside, it was from here that the wartime Lancasters of 617 Squadron took off on their historic Dambusters raid. Today, squadron commander and leader of the team is an ex-grammar school boy from Fleet in Hampshire, 33-year-old John Blackwell.
I started my career as a qualified flying instructor, so I went through my normal training, and at the end of that, I was sent back into the training system as an instructor after a suitable course. And following that tour, I joined the Red Arrows for the first time as a wingman at the end of 1973. After a tour with the Red Arrows, I went to fly the Jaguar from Coltishall in Norfolk, in number 54 squadron. And then I was lucky enough to get an exchange in the United States, flying A-10s. And I returned from the States to my present job. Obviously, when I first started leading, then one was perhaps a little bit more nervous until one had proved oneself. But generally now, although I still probably get butterflies every now and again, which is, I would think, probably healthy. Well, it's my job to fly as smoothly as I possibly can so that everyone else can follow me. Obviously, if I become a bit rough or I'm not having a good day or something like that, then I could actually put an input into the aircraft controls, which the other guys couldn't hang on to. But by the time we're down at display height, we've done the manoeuvres so often and I'm so used to having the chaps outside me that I'm aware of their relative height to the ground, for example, as opposed to my own relative height. A pilot's level of ability has to be taken as read, really. We need a chap who has probably been assessed as above average for the last few years in his previous unit. And then, probably the most important quality is compatibility. How will he get on with the pilots who are already on the team? Because we do end up spending a lot of time together, and also, for example, in the air, to be in the right place at the right time. Because if you're not, I suppose it could have fairly catastrophic results. If I were choosing the next leader of the Red Arrows, I'd look for A, somebody who'd been on the team before, B, somebody who'd been promoted, because that's a prerequisite for the job as well, somebody who is a reasonably stable character and doesn't get too bunched about things, I suppose, doesn't particularly require any, Adonis qualities or particularly superb physical fitness or anything like that. Experience is probably the most important thing that you're looking for. I think probably the thing that the general public doesn't appreciate is that there are fatal accidents throughout the Air Force. Fatal accidents aren't unique to the Red Arrows. Obviously it would have a fundamental effect because we know each other so well and it would knock the team for a little bit back a little bit, but in the past we've always managed after perhaps a couple of training sessions to come back. It's not possible to really quantify the level of risk.
After every display, the team watch a videotape of the main formation and of the two soloists, called the Synchro Pair. Chaired by John Blackwell, known as the Boss, it's often a critical occasion.
Teddy, at the start of the wine glass, are you deliberately sitting wide to take out some of the roll towards you?
No, I've been aware of being...
Just a shade.
Spare, a little bit spare. What do you suggest I should do?
No, I just noticed the last couple of displays, that's the last two or three, where you've tended to look just a shade wide at the start of the roll, but once we establish the roll, it's going fine.
There's a... Yeah. In fact, I was trying to fly that one shallow, because if I fly it deep, it looks slightly closer, but it looks back. Mm. I've been aware it hasn't been looking quite right.
I think we ran in synchro slipstream there, boss, because that came right down the line.
Let's push that back. There's no way that's in synchro slipstream there.
With the wind
nice,
it was?
Nice try.
No way.
Well, it was horrific.
We hit some slipstream on the threshold, just as the boss's colour went on, just about there.
We did, boss, because I got a thump it was, my airframe. That was...
Well, just watch the point at which the slipstream... it starts to flail. There's no way, guys, that is slipstream, because there's a 30 knot off crowd wind, and we were running down inside the synchro line.
Yep. Slipstream happened on the threshold, not before, not when that flailing went on, but on the threshold, because I remember at the time.
But the slipstream only gave you a bump.
It it was just like, I thought initially I'd hit a bird and then realised, I could see Phil coming underneath me and realised, and I'll show you where we hit it was about...
But That guys, is not slipstream. There's
about.
No way.
I don't know where it came from.
Well,
we hit slipstream.
Let's just summarise then the points on that show. In fact, the first half was quite tidy, wasn't there? There was nothing too dramatic on that. Good big nine, good diamond, initial diamond. Tornado was okay, card was good. Viggen was better, I think, you being that shade tighter, Simon. Wine glass, if there's something you can do about it easily, then try to. It's just something. It's just a small thing. Leader's benefit, if you can get yourself a little bit shallower, Simon, I think that'll help that initial rollout. Cascade was good. Rollback's just a little bit of a big one from you, Tim. Gear down bend was okay. Caterpillar, on the run-in, I think we just need to reiterate the point we've made before, is the rollout is always a worker, because sometimes I can't get the rolling out call in anyway, because synchro are chatting, or I don't want to block out a call. So I think the only way to play that is just to give yourself that little bit more in hand, so that if you do have a wobble come down, you can hold everything and let it wobble in front of you. Okay, so that wasn't a bad display, was it? Good for the third one of the day.
Already established as the joker in the pack, Flight Lieutenant Simon Bedford is just completing his first year with the team. What are his feelings now that he's been accepted?
It's a fulfilment of about... 6 or 7 years of real ambition, I think. Before that, I probably didn't think I could ever get there. I can't think of anything else that would give me the same excitement that I've got now, or the same satisfaction, job satisfaction, that I've got now from a purely flying point of view. It's even better than I thought it was going to be when I applied. I think there's a certain amount of envy between people who would like to do the job. I think... there is a certain amount of jealousy. I think there is a certain amount of thought that we are perhaps a bunch of prima donnas. That particular attitude is something which I'm fairly anxious to dispel, because I believe if I can do it, there are an awful lot of people in the Air Force who can do it. I just happen to be a fortunate person who's applied and got the job. I find that before a display, I tend to get, I suppose the word is, psyched up a little bit.
Certainly, as a teenager, when I was considering what sort of career to follow, there was never any doubt in my mind that I wanted to be a pilot in the Air Force.
I wanted to do it from the word go. I can remember being as a schoolboy sitting on the fence at Middleton St George, which is now Teesside Airport, watching the Black Arrows and the Blue Diamonds, and thinking then, that's what I want to do. And I've been very, very lucky. I've actually been able to do that. I just wonder how many more schoolboys sitting on fences around various airfields managed to do that.
I always wanted to be an engine driver, but I thought, no, aeroplanes would be more interesting. I suppose in my early teens, because my father was in the Air Force, so I've always lived on airfields and sort of been around aeroplanes, and I was very keen aviation enthusiast and things like this, so it seemed natural. And I started flying when I was 17, and kept going since.
I suppose really why I wanted to join the Red Arrows is it's always been a sort of burning ambition, which most pilots probably have in their Air Force career. I started flying Hunters about 10 years ago. And from there I moved on to Harriers. I went to Germany flying the Harrier, where I was lucky enough to be the display pilot in the Harrier. And I suppose that gave me a taste of display flying. And from there, one thing led to another, and I was lucky enough to be selected for the team. So, delighted.
I vividly remember going to my headmaster for a reference. And I said, all I want to do is go and fly. I want to go and fly fighters for the Air Force. And he looked me straight in the eye and he said, how about being a quantity surveyor?
Instead of becoming a quantity surveyor, John Blackwell led his team across the Atlantic to the giant Andrews Air Force Base in Washington. In the warm spring sunshine, this was to be the first display in a month-long tour of America, with the team playing their other role as ambassadors of Great Britain, and in front of a vast crowd. And to fill the VIP seats, there were busloads of American and British service chiefs, as well as a clutch of Washington diplomats. While John Blackwell briefed the pilots, the team manager, Eric Steensen, prepared for his other job as commentator in front of a crowd of 200,000 people.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, it's my pleasure to introduce to you the Royal Air Force Aerobatic Team for 1983. Ladies and gentlemen, the Red Arrows.
Fantastic.
Really?
I'm impressed. That's the ultimate in professionalism and accuracy and what flying is all about, and really what the military is all about.
With the first display of the American tour safely entered in his logbook, John Blackwell was introduced to the British ambassador in Washington, Sir Oliver Wright.
I was frightened to death. I thought it was an absolutely magnificent flying display and a magnificent airplane too. But I think what these young men managed to get up to in the sky.
What makes you so frightened, though?
Well, they look as if they're going to crash every minute, don't they? Well, I'm a very timorous wee beastie, you see, really.
Yes, sir. Wonderful. Great show.
I have to tell you that a couple of people said to me, I wouldn't like to sit beside you in a baseball team. You were elbowing and shouting bravo and screaming, etc. My feeling is that excellence like that has a very close relationship to, now get this, this is heavy, truth and beauty. And that's what I saw today. Wow!
By contrast, the crack American Air Force display team, the Thunderbirds, do things slightly differently. They fly the F-16, a full-blown and highly polished Mach 2 fighter.
For one of the most beautiful of formation maneuvers, the Diamond Roll. Watch the ballet-like precision as each wingman maintains perfect position on the leader. And now, the Thunderbirds and the graceful Diamond Roll. Watch for the mirror image as Major Jones and Captain Bostic fly in Calypso.
And again, doing things slightly differently, the Thunderbird pilots and their crew chiefs shake hands after each display. With a success rating of excellent, the team cross Niagara Falls on their way home from America to a different sort of air show, the International Air Tattoo at Greenham Common, where the last of the few Spitfires contrast with the aeroplanes of today.
When flying in a close formation display, certainly at the beginning when it's all new and different, you see nothing but the aeroplane you're staring at closest to you. As you get more experienced and more practiced, you find that that becomes automatic, the flying, and you're much more aware of what's going on around you. And now in my third year, and flying not too difficult a position as number two, I find I can see how many people are there on the crowd, and I'm very much aware of the weather conditions and where we are around the display. And you appreciate the nicer things, like if you're in a particularly attractive display site like Venice or Guernsey, then you're able to take in the view and the nice parts of it and where the sun is, etc. Whereas initially you see nothing but red aeroplanes and the odd burst of bright sun as it goes through your vision. And the Hawk is delightfully simple, and this is really a Morris Minor of aircraft.
The two-day event at Greenham Common draws together an impressive collection of fast jets from all over the world. The Phantom, Tomcat, Buccaneer, Eagle and Harrier. Pilots, there is the knowledge that the tiniest error or flaw in their display will be spotted instantly by their fellow experts. Experts like the flamboyant display team from Italy, the Frecchi Tricolori. How do they regard the red arrows?
You have, I suppose, the same manner to flight like us, no? It's a good show, it's a strong show, no?
And another view from the leader of the French aerobatic team, the Patrouille de France.
I think the red arrows have a very nice display. We enjoy very much the way they present the Hawk, and I think they are very accurate and very skilled pilots.
And the leader of the Austrian display team.
Red arrows performance, I've seen them yesterday, the very first time in this year, but I know them now since 76, and they are very, very excellent and professional team.
High praise indeed from the cool eye of the experts.
Will you be at Ramstein this year?
Yes, certainly we will. Super. So Ramstein is in 2 weeks.
That's right. Yes, we're taking a week's leave next week, and then we're doing a show in UK, and then we fly to Ramstein overnight.
The weekend begins with an early departure from Scampton, a display over the seafront at Bournemouth, then the transit flight to Ramstein, an American airbase in southern Germany.
I think it has anyway. Well, has anything to do with your waistline?
Well, it might have something to do
with that. I've forgotten what goes with it. Yeah, it's debris or something of that sort. Well, I get well.
Weather in Germany is okay.
Oh, good.
Good at Bournemouth. But it's
not going to be so good in German tomorrow.
Hercules from RAF Lynham becomes the airborne pantechnicon, swallowing all the support equipment and the engineering support team. During every display, the team will trail red, white and blue smoke. The white is diesel oil, the red and blue is a vivid chemical dye mixed with the diesel. The first job at Ramstein is the refilling of these in the Hawk's belly pod. Flight Sergeant Mike Harding runs the 25-man support team.
My job is basically to supervise the engineering side of this to ensure that it happens correctly and at the right time, you know, to ensure the show goes on.
It strikes me that it's a very pressurized job. You never seem to have very much time. You've got to have a very high record of serviceability.
All the time, yeah. We are 100% serviceable at all times, and if necessary, we work all night to achieve that aim. There is a fair bit of pressure with the job. Obviously the show's got to go on, and you just work to meet that criteria in the story. We can handle about 90% of anything that goes wrong with the aircraft. The other 10% is just too major for us to achieve. Time-wise, that is, it wouldn't be worth, say, trying to do anything that was going to take more than 24 hours because we would have moved on by then.
How does Flight Sergeant Mick Elwood see the job?
It's a split-year job. You do 6 months being away the whole time, being absolutely used to it, and it's 6 months of 8 to 5.
Is it a job you would recommend to anyone?
If you got a good stomach. Yeah, if you got a good stomach, you like late hours, yeah, I would. It's a job that you would really enjoy, yeah.
The wing of the Hercules becomes a useful grandstand for the team as they watch the Patrie de France perform their opposition loop. It was this maneuver when four aircraft passed the other four at the top of a loop, which was, later in the year, to cost the life of one pilot in the French team. Red arrows in Apollo. Seven arrow diving into the fan brake. The gear down bend. Running in for the caterpillar loop.
Aviation
After the flying, the Red Arrows invite some of their French comrades to watch the videotape of both the displays.
We used to do that as part of our eight ship show. If we had somebody sick, then.
Yes. Mm. It'd be a good idea if we did it now.
Do you have any problems in line astern with colour? If a guy smokes colour in front of somebody in line astern, does he get colour all over his car?
Yes.
So tell you, we. You know how we do the five. Have you seen our 5-4 split?
Never. This isn't a flat show.
Yeah. And rolling.
I never saw. I will never see a flat show from the radar.
I didn't dare go.
After the return flight to Sqdn, the Hawks are towed into the hangar, and the Hercules pauses just long enough to unload men and equipment before returning to Lynham. Squadron leader Ted Ball, a veteran of 70 missions in the Falklands conflict, flies as Red 5 in the team.
The life on the team when we go away at weekends is obviously very special. We get well treated and so on. But when I come home, we put the airplanes to bed in the hangar. I go home, I'm confronted with all the normal problems that anyone else in the country has. I'm looking for a mortgage. I'm looking for a house. It's proving quite difficult at the moment. I have difficulty parking my car and I get done for speeding. So, you know, life is very normal outside the team.
Life outside the team for Welshman Curly Hurst from Pontypool is fly fishing. And like Ted Ball, this is his first year with the team.
We start off with very gentle manoeuvres at a reasonable altitude, say between 3,000-5,000 feet. And normally with the boss leading, or the deputy boss can lead for some of these sorties. And I think the first sortie we did, it was basically three ship. There was the boss, there was Simon, myself. We climbed up to reasonable height and we explored close formation probably beyond the bounds of what I'd ever done before in one sortie, which was quite exciting and quite hard work. Of course, you're trying to squeeze the top of the stick like a toothpaste tube and applying a lot of the wrong techniques and really being very tense initially. But you soon calm down and relax, and basically that's what it's all about, I think, being able to relax in the air. And this takes, I think, probably about 3 or 4 months before you're absolutely relaxed.
But how does John Blackwell keep a professional eye on the new men flying directly behind him?
The boss is very aware of what's going on down the back. Even now he's aware of what's going on back in the 8 and 9 slot, because he's got these amazing mirrors which are convex. And it's just like looking into a fisheye lens. You can actually see everything that's going on behind you and below you. So we never escape. We can't get away with anything.
Hello, Vic. It's John Blackwell here. I'm just ringing up about the weather for our practice tomorrow morning at about 8:45. What are you expecting?
For the boss, a day off is a day to cope mm-hmm. with the office work.
OK, what sort of cloud base is that then?
In an average year, the team will fly about 120 displays in half a dozen different countries. The manager, Squadron Leader Eric Steenson, does the organising.
Eric, I've got a message on my desk to call a guy about a helicopter at St Athan. Do you know anything about it?
Yes, there was something in yesterday. Hang on a second. I made a note on the front here. There will be a Puma with a camera in it. It's going to be a 1,000-foot crowd rear at 3,000 feet in height and about 4,000-foot crowd left.
OK. Have we got a contact number for the pilot himself? Because I'm not sure whether this chap is the pilot or just somebody.
No.
OK.
No.
Well, I'll maybe get it from
this guy. I can either get it from Odeon or from St Athan.
Fine. OK. Well, I'll call up and see what they want to
do. OK.
For
Red Arrows, runway to Stevenson. Yes, that's right. Well, yes, if you can give me the details, we don't actually control the displays that we participate in. You'll need to go through the Participation Committee and the Minister of Defence. But if you'd like to give me the date that you're thinking of, I can give you some idea as to whether we're already booked or not. Yep. Okay, can you just hold on a moment? Yes, at the moment we're only planned to practice that day, but if I give you the address, if you'd like to write direct to the Minister of Defence.
Although the team keep a reserve aircraft, the display routine is so complex there's no point in having a reserve pilot. So, on family day at Scampton, Eric Stinson demonstrates aerobatics in a more mundane aeroplane, the Cranfield A1. Family day means a practice display and then a chance for friends and relatives to have a closer look at the hawks. Away from work, it's still things mechanical and fast for John Myers, Red 3 in the team, with his wife Jackie.
How's it going?
All right, apart from the sound effects I'm getting from there, I'd rather have the sound effects from this end, still.
Are you helping Daddy cook?
Good. Good boy. Just don't turn it on, otherwise you'll electrocute everybody.
Had you better come out now?
No.
No, righto.
Okay. You stay in there, then.
I think I would have found John an attractive person in any case, because he wasn't actually in the Air Force when I first met him. We had a long engagement waiting for him to join the Air Force, but I always hated the idea of any job that was 9 to 5. I never did a 9-to-5 job myself. I like the disruptions and I like the moving around. I suppose a bit of a modern day gypsy, really. Whatever job a man chooses to do, there's always got to be some element of risk. And having faith in his own profession and his own abilities, I feel, is what a wife is all about. A good wife has got to be behind a husband.
Can I have a piece?
Huh?
Can I have a bit? Just a little bit.
Top.
Thank you.
Well, it is nice, isn't it?
Yeah.
Mm. You want some of my coffee with it?
Yeah.
It's a bit hot. Watch it. It's all right.
It's not
that
hot.
Yeah, all right then. Wait till it cools down.
I cannot understand anybody that has a love for flying. I enjoy it to get from A to B for a reason, but I can't understand people that spend all their money at flying clubs, etc., because they've got this almost a disease, they need to fly, but it just hasn't turned me on at all.
Family Day is one of the most popular events in the team's calendar. With his family in Cirencester, Henry de Coursier, this year's synchro leader. Right. His wife, Jan.
If I sit and watch a display, I find it quite nerve-wracking, especially now that Henry's doing solo. When he was in the whole 9 or 7 that was left over, then there wasn't any problem because I never knew where he was in the first place. But while he's doing solo, I do tend to, when they cross over. But if I actually sit and watch it on the television or on a film, then there's no problem at all. You somehow disassociate yourself with the whole doings.
Tim Miller, Red 4, is responsible for the meticulous planning of display routes and timings.
Right, we're displaying at Guernsey on the 15th of this month. And I already know the display time of 11:40 Zulu, which is the GMT times. It'll be 12:40 local at Guernsey. Now, we're operating out of Jersey, and I already know that the display site is St. Peter Port on Guernsey, and I know the display axis. So I work back from that, and I look at a suitable way of of getting into the display site, so we don't have to do too many turns. And I've drawn up a suitable route, and it so happens that that route takes 6 minutes and 2 seconds. So working back to actually get there at 12:40 local will roll physically breaks off on the runway at Jersey at 12:33 and 58 seconds. And doing it that way, we can virtually guarantee that we'll be within a couple of seconds on the display site. Obviously, if there's a headwind or tailwind, then we'll have to adjust our ground speed to get there in the exactly right time, and that's the boss's job. Ian and myself do all the planning, so I'll do this display. Ian will have taken us to Jersey, and then we do the display at Guernsey, and then I'll take us up to Scotland, and then he'll take us down to from Scotland back here. And then later on that day, I think I'm taking us from Scampton to Cologne-Bonn, which in Germany, that's the one I'm planning at the moment.
Before takeoff for each display, John Blackwell briefs the team. To the outsider, it sounds just a tangle of numbers and abbreviations.
Start time, the wind here is all across the runway, so we'll plan to start at minute... check-in at minute 42 for a 48 and 31 second roll, OK? Taxiing will be then for runway 05. Takeoff will be a standard transit takeoff coming left. The fuel course will be SOP 400, 200 and lights. It's a joker from the site of 300 kgs, direct line back to Scampton. End of display options then. Assuming we finish on a fully, okay, it'll be, I'll be going straight ahead for a couple of nanoseconds and then coming right onto heading a 097. So everybody will be following Henry out, okay? If we don't get in for the join-up loop, then I'll bend left, come down the line, and then just go straight ahead off the spaghetti, and everyone once again will be following Henry out. And it's on that rejoin if you end up fairly well to the west to be aware of, once you get to the A1, to make sure you've got 800 feet plus to avoid these crop sprayers. OK. In the unlikely event that we finish on a vixen, then I will be coming off left and out towards Harrogate. OK, on the route back then, down the A1 to Ferry Bridge, over Finningley. We may get vectored around Finningley if they're screwing it up. Shall we do a spaghetti, another spaghetti here? OK. So we'll come in from the cooling towers, overfly Scampton. I'll check that that crop spray is on the ground. He should be when we come back, because there is one just inside the Mertz. Overfly, join into 9 arrow, 6-7 to the wings, join up loop formation, go, and then pulling up, probably for a crowd right landing if the wind is still all across, so that we've got a minimum taxi, okay? Emergencies are SOP here. Remember, no barrier, nice long runway, overruns average at the far end. So if you're in real trouble and going to something nasty, think about raising the gear and punching out. Escape routes are all SOP, as is lost lead, which shouldn't apply today anyway.
For an insight into why the team is so successful, listen to John Blackwell explaining the careful choreography behind the display.
I just fly a wing over for them, and when they get into position like that, then they tell me that they're all aboard, and I call for the smoke to go off. And we're running just behind the crowd, I call for the smoke to come on, and then as we start our pull up, just before I pull up, I'll call pulling up, and then when we get to about 30 degrees of nose up, I'll call for the change, first formation change into diamond. Over the top of the loop, I throttle back a little bit and bend the loop to the right, as you can see there, before reversing left, and I'll tell everybody what I'm doing. So at this stage it would be go reversing left now, and then we're into something like a 4G turn all the way around the corner.
What's your speed?
This sort of speed at the moment, we're probably doing about 330 knots, something like that. And at this stage here, I'm just feeling the turn to try and get the apex of the turn right in front of the crowd. Just after we pass the crowd, I'll call for the smoke to go off, and I'll call that I'm rolling out into a wing over, another wing over. Once again, looking for that point on the ground, my roll point, as I call it, and pulling up for a barrel roll in wine glass. I can actually see the guys. Most of the time, I can't see the wingmen, but for the wine glass roll, I can actually see the chaps either side of me quite clearly. And as I bottom the loop, I'll call rolling out, and then I call for the synchro pair to split. And we complete what we call the leader's benefit loop. And this is where the manager comes in, because he has to draw his attention, everyone's attention to the synchro pair, who come in each time from left and right. Normally their closing speed is somewhere between 600 and 700 miles an hour, and they're pulling anywhere up to 4 or 5 G. What happens in this particular one is that flight attendant de Corsier number 6 will fly the manoeuvre, and number 7 will fly the same manoeuvre and miss him. And obviously red 6 never takes avoiding action, it's always up to 7.
Whereas the other seven aeroplanes provide a more artistic picture in the sky, we provide the thrill and just the risk and the thrill of a head-on manoeuvre and for the crowd's point of view in the meanwhile.
It's no more exciting than passing someone on a motorway. Obviously, as you gain experience and a little bit more confidence, you start bringing it closer and closer to the other guy. But even so, it's such a natural progression, it never really ever... you know, this is the first time, grit your teeth. It's never ever like that at all. It's just a natural progression. There are, you know, areas which you could slip up with in the job, and things can get dangerous very, very quickly. But as a rule, it is a routine job for us, and we sort of treat it as such. Obviously, we go about it very carefully, but, you know, it's fairly standard.
And as they clear, ideally, we come in for our next manoeuvre, the caterpillar. And as I'll call the pull-up for this, I'll pull into the loop with about 3.5 to 4 Gs on board. And then everyone follows at a suitable separation. It's not a second or anything, it's just a fan-type manoeuvre. Immediately the chap in front has pulled away, then the chap behind goes behind him. Over the top of the loop, which probably is a little bit smaller loop than many of the others, at about 4,400 feet, and then coming out of the bottom of that, the synchro pair on stage again for their carousel. While they've been doing that, we've been positioning behind the crowd for our final manoeuvre, which is the join-up loop. And what I'm aiming to do here is put the parasol bomb burst almost vertically over the crowd, just a little bit in front of the crowd. Over the top of the loop, 120 knots, something like that, then throttling back and looking for the vertical position where I call for the brake, go. Everyone puts their smoke on and splits. Everyone goes through 40 degrees.
A normal tour for a pilot with the Red Arrows is 3 years. Each year, three pilots leave, and from volunteers throughout the Air Force, three more are picked to join. About to leave the team are Henry de Corsier, John Myers, and Ian Huzzard.
I'm going to Germany on a Harrier squadron, and I'll spend 3 years out there with the odd burst in South Atlantic and Belize, just to keep me busy.
Well, I've been banished to the Northern Marches, and I'm actually going back to a Buccaneer squadron up at Lossiemouth in the north of Scotland as a flight commander. So, yes, that's going to be very, very different too. The style of living and the style of operations is quite different.
I'm going down to Devon to a gunnery school to teach beginners weaponeering.
We are put on a stage, if you like, to perform, and eventually, after 3 years, the curtain comes down, for us three anyway.
I think the thing that I'll take away is the side where we work with the civilian population. You actually, in the military, can get quite blinkered into your own little world and everything, and yet there are another 50 million other people out in the country.
And for the three incoming pilots, is there a sage word of advice to offer?
Yeah, beware of the Black Widow in Jersey. Oh, no. A word of advice. I think not to get disillusioned too much during the first winter that the job's impossible, because it tends to click in the first part of the new year. that you can actually do the job. For the autumn, when they first start, you think the job is impossible and you just can't get it done, but that isn't the case. So I think that's the only advice.
As a follow-on to that, when you think that you have got it hacked and you really have got it all squared away and it's easy, look out, because that's the time when it really does get you out. I would agree with that, but the advice I would give is it only lasts 3 years, it's tremendous, and just enjoy it.
The three new pilots are Flight Lieutenants Tony Lullenwood, Ross Boyens, and Peter Lees. And what they hope to become is a part of this, the most exciting, the most skilled aerobatic team in the world.
Red Arrows Tower, clear takeoff, surface wind, there's 2405 knots.
Red.